What's up? Someone tell me my mic is working today. Is it working? I always have myself muted. I think it's working. Okay. Hi, everyone. Hi. Sorry. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you so much for being here with me. I literally switched my setup like 5 minutes before I went on here. So I'm like, is everything okay? I have the mic on this side now. If you are an avid watcher of my videos, the mic used to be on this side, but it was blocking my background. So I decided to switch it up. Anyway, hello, hello. If you are watching, say hello. Okay, everyone is here, here, here. Someone's asking about my lipstick. I don't have it with me, but I'm wearing the Maybelline matte. What's it called? Maybelline matte. Whatever, it's like in a tube. It's in my Amazon storefront. I don't know if this color is, though. I'll find out and I'll get back to you. Welcome, welcome. Hello, everyone. I'm super excited to be here. Noma says, couldn't wait for this. You know what? Neither could I. Very excited. Honestly, okay, I'm gonna be fully transparent. I don't really have a plan for tonight. I figured we would just hang out and figure it out together, okay? Love it, love it. Okay, let me call in my SOS support and I will get the lipstick color for you. Everyone, please hold. This is urgent and important. In the meantime, you can let me know in the chat what you're drinking this evening. I have, as per usual, my President's Choice sparkling water. No, this is not sponsored. But I do drink a lot of it in a week, and they probably should sponsor me, let's be honest. Okay, in the second drawer, grab the zipper bag. Okay, let's see if he can decipher my message. Cherry Coke, we love it. I just finished a sugar-free, caffeine-free Diet Coke, as per usual. If you're a member here on my channel, you will see that you now have, I'm going to try and pull it up, a Diet Coke emoji. Oh my God, Lori, thank you so much. YouTube doesn't tell me when, so I use Restream to do my live videos. It doesn't tell me when people buy memberships or gift memberships. So I really, really appreciate that so much. And make sure if you are watching this video that you have the option turned on for people to be, oh, thank you so much, for people to be able to gift you memberships so that if by chance someone is generous enough to donate memberships, you are able to grab those for yourself. Thank you so much. I really appreciate that. And thank you, Rights Mind, for the super chat or super sticker. You are amazing. No. You are amazing. So, yes, all that to say, if you are a member, you now have access to a Diet Coke emoji, which is super fun. I also have emojis with my pets. So, we have Bubba, we have Firefox, we have Bubba being hypnotized, a pyramid, money, all the good stuff. Okay, we are here. We are here. We are here. We have the lipstick. So, the one I am currently wearing, as you can see, I have a little bit of an obsession. The one I am currently wearing is this one. So, it looks like this. It is the. It's called Self Starter. How appropriate for this channel. Number 130. And it just looks like this. Like you just like paint it on. Can you tell I'm not a beauty influencer? So there's this one. And then this is the one that I wear in a lot of my videos. This one's my favorite one. It's the Mover. And then the other ones are like darker shades. But yeah, now you know. The more you know. Marette says, I totally manifested this gifted membership. You know what? All you got to do next is just imagine yourself as a millionaire, and soon you will be one. The point of my membership is to teach you all how to become millionaires. That's really why we're all here tonight, actually, as well. Welcome to the Millionaire Mastermind. I just picked up Ruler. I think I have that one, or it's on my wish list. Voyager, Lover, Exhilarator, Self-Starter, and Mover. So no. But we do love it. We love the matte lipstick. 10 out of 10 would recommend. Sorry for the detour. This was the super sticker I got. Thank you again so much. I really appreciate it. Let me just scroll through the comments here and make sure I didn't miss anything. Brita filtered non-pH controlled water. Ugh, you really got to invest in a Kangen. Just kidding. If you haven't listened to Andrew Huberman's Huberman Lab podcast about alkaline water, y'all definitely should, because he debunks a lot of the stuff these MLM girlies like to spew. Scarlet Letter handcrafted spiked seltzer. Sounds good. Yeah, Pablo is our hero. We appreciate him. He's really the one running everything behind the scenes. Let's manifest Ray Ray videos. You know what? I haven't dove into the world of Ray Higdon yet. We'll see if it comes up on the docket yet or eventually. But I got a big long list that I got to work through before we get there. Yeah, exactly. That's what I was going for, Sarah. Not drinking anything right now because I'm chilling in bed at 1 a.m. I'm not really sure the sound of my voice is what I would want to be listening to at 1 a.m., but I'm happy you're here. Okay, so as I mentioned, or I don't even know what I'm doing, honestly, I decided to do this video because someone submitted a scam story through my submission form, which is linked down below, by the way, where you can submit times that you've been scammed by business coaches, life coaches, whatever, and either have the option to have me read your story on my channel, or you can come on for an interview. And so I kind of like half read the story and was like, okay, it's about Amy Porterfield. Let's just do a live stream about her and we'll read the scam story as well while we're at it. I don't believe the submission was like very dramatic, so it didn't really make sense for me to do a full video about that one specific story. But if you have a story where you have been sort of taken advantage of, we'll say, by a life or business coach and you want to have me read it out on my channel, you can fill out that form. It's linked in the description. Okay, Rosie Posey says, I just manifested my daybook / planner for next year. And by manifested, I mean ordered online. That's exactly how we're all going to become millionaires as well. We're going to join my membership and manifest how to be a millionaire by doing it on your own. Hello, Shadow. No, I have not heard of Jessica Lindholm. Let me do a quick little Google. I don't think so. Who dis? To Living Free, a writer, thought leader, coach, and queen of ease. Oh, God. Anyone who calls themselves a thought leader, red flag. Unless you're me. I am a thought leader, leading us all to manifest millions. This is all sarcasm, by the way. If you don't interpret sarcasm very well, nothing I say here is real. And I guess it's a good time to read my disclaimer. The information shared in this video comes from my own personal experience and opinion. The content in this video is stated as opinion, not fact, and is intended for the purpose of consumer education and entertainment only. Thank you for being here. Okay, Wright's Mind, if you are on your phone, you can't. You have to go to a computer. So if you're on a desktop, there should be a join button down below this video. Or if you go to my channel page, the join button will be there as well. I can also message it to you on Instagram later, the link to sign up. Even the term influencer makes me shudder. I know anytime I introduce myself to people, I'm like, I am a content creator. They're like, oh, so you're an influencer? I'm like, absolutely not. I do not influence anybody, or at least I hope not. Oh, painful. Oh God, there's something on Facebook about making millions from watching YouTube. Honestly, there's videos saying that you can make $1 million doing like literally anything. Make $1 million from your phone. Make $1 million in the ocean. Make $1 million standing on your head. That's the attitude we like around here, Janaea. 1 million is a rookie number. I am manifesting towards being a billionaire. Take me with you. I want to come on this adventure of becoming a billionaire. You know what? Reaction Therapy requested that I introduce a $20 tier to my membership where we can do like one-on-one or like a group sort of Google Meet call once a month. Maybe that will be the billionaire tier. And if you join that tier, I will make you a billionaire. I have a scam story. It's YouTube not letting me sign up on my phone. How freaking rude, right? If anyone has a workaround for how to join memberships from your phone, please put it in the chat. I don't know how to do it. I don't think it works though. Maybe if you went to YouTube through your like Google Chrome browser or Safari or whatever kind of phone you use. You do remind me of myself. Sarcastic, where you know me, where you have to know me to get it's sarcasm. Exactly. I feel like I speak a lot of the times in like a very monotone voice. So if you don't know me, you might think I'm being serious, but like literally nothing I say is that serious. You know what? This is a great question. He's asking if I'm a Degrassi character. Unfortunately, no. I didn't grow up in Toronto. However, if I did, I probably would have been on an episode of Degrassi. Let's be real. Okay, so Maria is saying if you're on an iPhone, you can open Safari and ask for the web version of YouTube. So yeah, if you do that way, maybe. Yeah, if you go to a... Yeah, okay, thanks. Mr. Ranger Lab says the same. You can sign up on your phone if you go through the internet. Cool, cool, cool. Okay, no worries, Lisa. Sorry, I'm trying to share and everything's moving so quickly. I'm sewing while I listen, so might not comment much. No worries, no worries. We'll be here. Love it. Lori's eating pizza. Frankie says, can't confirm. Were you on Degrassi? Let me know. I want to know what episode so I can watch it. Heather says, I wish I was in Degrassi. If only it were that easy. Okay. Thank you. Mr. Ranger Lab has posted the instructions on how to join a membership from your phone if you are here to figure that out. And if you join, comment because Restream doesn't tell me and I have to figure it out on my own 5 minutes later. Okay, I'm just blabbering, wasting time at this point. Thank you all for being here. As I mentioned, today we're going to be talking about Amy Porterfield. Everything that I share is alleged based on experiences, things I've read on the internet, or my own opinion. So again, don't take it too seriously, okay? I guess I'll start by reading the submission that came in through my scam stories. And once again, I haven't really read this. I kind of like briefly read through it and then was like, okay, I'll just throw it in the video. So let's do it together. I'm not going to share the screen just because there is some like personal information this person shares. And I don't want that to be like, I don't want to dox this person. So I'll go ahead and read the story. I'll come back to the chat and then we're going to do some snooping. Again, I didn't really make a plan, but I have her Instagram open, her website and that kind of thing. So that for those of you that aren't really familiar with who Amy Porterfield is, in fact, I don't really know who she is that well. I know like little pieces here and there. I know she hangs out with Jenna Kutcher a lot. A story for another day, I suppose. Maybe that'll be next week's live stream where we'll deep dive into Jenna Kutcher. But yeah, let's go ahead and read the story. So this one says, I bought two classes from Amy Porterfield right around COVID time. I had time, I had very little money, but I was bracing myself for having to work from home and having a side hustle or pivoting altogether because the world was coming to an end, basically. I feel like a lot of people were in that position during that time. COVID was obviously a very vulnerable time for many of us. As a small business owner myself at that time, I know it was really, really stressful for me and so many other people that I know as well. So definitely an opportune time for the grifters to push their grift. In my opinion, my personal opinion based on my own experiences. I first bought the List Builders Society and subbed. We're going to go to our website so we'll figure out what all this stuff is later. Learning to build my email list and then during COVID, I signed up for the Digital Course Academy so I could learn how to set up my own online courses. First of all, cost. One price paid up front, if split, it is higher. This is something that I've talked about so many times on this channel and people will often disagree with me because my stance on having a payment plan, like as a business owner, I offer payment plans to all of my clients, to anyone who wants to buy a product from me, because my mission as a business owner is to make small business as accessible as possible to as many people as possible. What I see a lot of these online service providers do, and it's something that's kind of like encouraged, just sort of unspoken in the industry, is that if you are going to offer a payment plan, you actually make the payment plan more expensive than if the person were to pay in full, because you want the incentive to be for the person to pay in full. So if I have a program that's $1,000, if you pay me $1,000 upfront, it's $1,000. But if you need a payment plan, then I'm actually going to charge you, let's say, three payments of $350, so that I end up getting like a little bit of extra money out of you needing a payment plan. And so for me personally, from my own business and my values as a business owner, that doesn't align with me. And so I'm never going to offer a payment plan that ends up costing the client more money. However, it is very common in this sort of like online coaching space to have payment plans set up in that way. So I just wanted to kind of touch on that. Okay. I am literally being punished for not having enough money. Again, oftentimes the reason why people need payment plans is because they don't have the money to afford the thing in the first place. And so if you're charging them more money to help them afford it, you're actually hurting them in the long run, again, in my opinion. Facebook group calls, which were pre-recorded, webinars were also pre-recorded, and I had friends who also joined, but you couldn't see the names. I mean, that could just be a privacy thing. This online webinar is fake as it gets out, and after having paid money for the course, I felt used. So I guess what they're saying is they joined a webinar, which they then bought the program from, only to later find out that the webinar was fake. Again, if you've watched many of my other live streams, we know this. A lot of these webinars are pre-recorded. They aren't live. They bait questions into the chat to make it look like it's live, but it's all just set on an evergreen loop, meaning that anyone can sign up at any time and we'll all end up watching the same webinar. That's like sales funnels 101, but obviously if you're not aware of how the industry works, the first time you see a webinar, you're going to think it's live. That happened to me. I remember the very first thing I almost bought online was a $1,000 course on how to build an online course, of course. And now in retrospect, I realized that it was a pre-recorded webinar, but at the time I was like, oh my God, this is the best thing I've ever watched. But again, sales funnel 101, don't trust anyone on the internet. I finished the course. I launched mine, failed, and went and retook the other courses as I had lifetime access. In 6 months, there was an update where Amy Porterfield partnered with other entrepreneurs. And now they became a staple as she became their affiliate. So she was getting paid if we bought into Neil Patel or used any of her other online tools. So for example, Amy makes a ton of money, as she should, from Kajabi. This is very common. Again, a lot of these large scale business owners have affiliate links. I personally don't have anything wrong with people using affiliate links, making commission off that. The like referring each other to their friends programs thing is a little bit not genuine, I would say, but it's not really something that I dislike per se, in my personal opinion. You can let me know your thoughts in the comments. For example, Amy makes a ton of money, as she should. Oh, from Kajabi, they have a very healthy commission. ClickFunnels is another, and Aweber, and all of those other tools that she teaches people to use. We get to learn on our own how to use and troubleshoot these while she collects commissions. Again, it's an affiliate link. I have affiliate links. Just because I tell you to buy a mic on Amazon doesn't mean I'm going to teach you how to use the mic on Amazon. But again, that's just my opinion. I'm not trying to be rude or insensitive. But I don't think having affiliate or making affiliate commission is necessarily like an unethical thing to do, especially as long as she's disclosing, like, if you use my Kajabi link, I'm going to get $100 or whatever it is. Okay. Sorry. That was a bit of a tangent. You can literally Google one of these and see what they offer their affiliates and do the math. If 100 or 1,000 people signed up for her fake webinar and calculate out the commissions. I have yet to meet anyone who has been successful in starting their online biz. All of her books, all of her PowerPoints and webinars are made in Canva. After Amy, I looked into the Doer's Inner Circle, and it's basically the same thing. A lovely gal who started an online business and sold a $37 ebook she made on Canva. I used Canva and could do a better job. I bought one book and laughed. Same as Amy Porterfield, I just gave up. It's so disheartening. Instead of supporting women and providing real pathways, these people have found a way to prey on those who have little and are trying to find ways to build themselves up. I don't want to do an interview, but I'm happy to converse via email. Okay. So that was that. Sorry, a little bit long-winded. Essentially, this person signed up, took the course. Here's the Cliff Notes version. Didn't get any results. Shocker. And wanted to share their story. So I really apologize that if you are watching this video and that was your experience, obviously that sucks. It's happened to me. It's happened to many of the people I've interviewed here on this channel. That is why I make the content that I do. And that's why we're here to talk about it today. Let me catch up on the comments. Heather is asking, are these webinars usually marketed as live or pre-recorded? They are marketed as live. So this is what will happen. I know this because I used to have one of these. So a lot of the time, these people will use a platform like Webinar Jam, which is literally an evergreen webinar platform. So what would happen is I would make the webinar slides. I would sit down in my office and I would actually pre-bait the questions. So let's say I was offering a webinar that fed into like a $5,000 mastermind. What I would want to do is feed questions at the end of the webinar that are going to be like things I would think my ideal client is going to be asking about the mastermind. Also, like kind of suggesting that the people who are asking the questions are interested. So in Webinar Jam specifically, you can create fake names and input fake questions to then be asked, like the software will ask them, kind of like here on the screen, how I have Heather's question linked. It'll do that. So I would go into Webinar Jam. I would host the webinar. So I would give the PowerPoint presentation as if it was live. And then when I got into the Q&A section, I would have the questions start to pop up on the screen and I would start answering them as if someone was in the chat asking those questions. So you can also like pre-record what shows up in the chat. So if any of you have ever attended a webinar and the person at the beginning is like, hey, everyone, where are you from? Like drop where you're from in the chat and you see people like Kentucky, Ontario, Alberta, blah, 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 blah. And it's like all popping up in the chat. Those can all be fake technically. Like you could pre-fill that. Some of these large scale entrepreneurs will host the first webinar live and then just like reuse that replay. So kind of like how we have the live chat here on YouTube, what would happen is once you go and watch like the replay essentially that you're being told is live, your questions will fill in with the other like actual live chat. So anyways, I would show up, I would do this like fake live webinar, have all the stuff fill in, and then I would post it on my website to rerun every day or however often at a set time. So that's why a lot of the times when you go to sign up for one of these webinars, you'll see that there's like 5 time slots available each day of the week. It's because it's running on loop. It's like a re-recording that they're just playing over and over and over again. Okay, sorry, I'm just getting caught up on comments. Hi, 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 hi. Also, now's a good time to mention, DC and I are going live. I'm trying to do the math here. In like 2.5 hours, 7 p.m. Pacific. So 9 p.m. Central, 10 p.m. Eastern together. So I'm going to go live until about 6 p.m. my time. So another hour and a half. And then I'm going to take a break and then I'm going to be back. So I just wanted to mention that now before I forget. Okay. Love it. Okay. Thank you everyone for being here. Hi, Eloise. Nice to see you. Okay. Is it just me? Or is Canva sort of a weird place to make an online book? Let's talk about this. So I have created ebooks in Canva. I think it depends on what the content is that you're creating. Canva is nice because the design tools are really easy to use. I think it's like, what's the word? Very easily accessible to people who maybe don't have like design experience. But I personally don't really think it's weird, but maybe somebody else has a different perspective that I don't know. Hello, hello, DC. Okay, I'm going to link DC's channel here in 3 hours when I figure out. I really need to figure out how to get a Nightbot to work, but haven't done that yet. So that's a problem for another day. Here's DC's channel. If anyone is not already subscribed to her, you should be. Again, we're going live in a couple hours. So stay tuned. They sit on a throne of lies. Yes, 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 yes. Okay. Oh, thank you. Welcome, welcome. Sorry, Restream doesn't tell me when people join my membership. So welcome. Make sure you use those emojis, emotes, whatever they're called here on YouTube. I don't even know. Okay, so Natalie says she doesn't like Canva as a place for ebook creation. I don't know. I feel like the software itself has been like in the past few years, especially with the rise and people like wanting to make money on the internet, they've made a lot of templates and stuff that make it really easy. Yeah, Lisa, the more you know. Lisa didn't know that you could fake chat questions. Unfortunately, I can't here on YouTube, so if no one shows up to my live stream, it's just me. But thankfully, live chat is here to carry the team. So thank you all for being here. Sorry, I'm just catching up on all the comments. I think it's a different thing if you recommend things to set up the business. That is what paid to learn. Yeah, exactly. So as long as I'm not like forced, so sorry, this is going into the affiliate link commission, I think, but as long as I'm not saying like you have to buy this in order to be successful, instead, I think there is space to be like, hey, these are the tools I use in my business. Feel free to use my affiliate link. Like, I have friends here on YouTube that have affiliate links for like Restream, Ecamm, that kind of thing. Like, hey, if you're going to sign up anyway, you might as well use my link and, you know, give me a cut. I don't think there's anything really wrong with that. It's the same way I have an Amazon storefront linked in my description. It's like, these are the lipsticks I wear. If you want to buy them, just click my link and then I get 2 cents. Like, thank you so much. I say that because I've literally made like $2 on Amazon affiliates in my lifetime. So, anyways, yes. Okay. So Eloise is saying, I'm pretty sure that happened to me. She ignored all my questions about actually running a business, but suddenly one's about the paid course. Exactly. So if you've ever been on a webinar and you're asking questions and you feel like you're being ignored, this is probably why, because they already pre-baited their own fake questions and only answered those. They're not actually there to answer any live questions. Unless you're like the only place you can genuinely host a webinar where you can answer people's questions live, at least in my experience, is like Facebook. Anyways, I am so far behind. Sorry. Yes, Phoenix, I agree. Phoenix is saying it's weird when they charge you $100 for a Canva PDF. Absolutely agree. Again, I am always very transparent with like the products that I sell and have. I have an ebook that I made in Canva that I sell online for $9. Because the information in it is valuable, but I created it in Canva. So there's also a difference between like creating, like taking time to create a good product versus just like using a Canva template and then slapping a price tag on it. Big ick. Okay, Sp Space Pastry says I took only one of her courses that convert a little over $1,000 in 2017 wasn't helpful. Ugh, I'm so sorry that happened. Yeah, I was right before I came on, my partner was like, oh, so like who are you talking about today? I'm like, oh, we're covering Amy Porterfield. He's like, who's that? I'm like, oh, like she's, you know, one of these people, but she's one of the OGs, so she's like right at the top. And she sells a course teaching people how to sell a course. So we all know where that's gonna go. yeah. I see. So Natalie's saying it's not a matter of liking or not liking, it's that there's a better option. Yeah, that makes sense. Especially if you're like actually in like the book industry. I wouldn't imagine like writing a whole book. I'm just thinking like an ebook that's 10 pages and has a little bit of information in it. Okay. Sorry, I'm so far behind. Yes. Okay. This is a really good point. So Janae is saying, I personally don't think Canva is a problem for products as a design service isn't sold. I would be upset if I found out I paid for a logo design and they use Canva. Exactly. I think that's the key difference is like if you're using Canva to take knowledge and information you have and like package it aesthetically, that's one thing. But if I'm like selling people on the design itself, that would be really shady. Definitely, definitely. Okay, I'm glad we're all learning about pre-recorded fake webinars. This is a thing. I would recommend or I would speculate that like 99% of the like large scale grifters, the like grifters in my opinion, the Tony Robbins, Amy Porterfields, Jenna Kutchers, Rachel Hollises, et cetera. Anyone who has a webinar, they're not doing it live. That's not real. Except like the, what's that thing called that we watched a couple weeks ago? The Tony Robbins, Dean Graziosi thing. That thing's live. Like they're talking and blah, blah, blah. They're 5-day event. Sure. But any kind of webinar? Absolutely not. Especially, again, if they have multiple days and multiple times. Like I've seen ones where I could pick any day of the week and there was like 5 time slots a day. Those are all pre-recorded. But they're made to look like they're live. Literally go to webinarjam.com and you'll know what I'm talking about. Okay, moving along. Now that I've ranted for a lot of time, I thought we could look at Amy's website so that those of us who aren't super familiar with who she is and what she does, we can get better acquainted. So let me go ahead and share my screen. Hopefully that's good. Oh, I'm so happy to hear that, DC. I'm glad that you guys were able to connect. And I'm looking forward, let me make my face big, to trolling on the internet with you later. Yeehaw! Yeehaw! Okay, anyway, back to snarking. Okay, so, hello, this is Amy Porterfield, everyone. And if you landed on my little slice of the internet, you're probably a business owner or entrepreneur or flirting with the idea of becoming one, or you're a YouTuber with nothing better to do with your time. Hi, it's me. So come in, kick off your shoes, and fill your Google Drive with the free resources, trainings, and action steps necessary to build a highly engaged email list, create online training courses, and use online marketing strategies to sell with ease. Then we have the list of all the places she's been featured, blah, blah, blah. And here comes the pitch. I've been where you are, scattering free content and paid opportunities into the void of the internet with zero return. After years of winging it, missing my son's football games to meet client deadlines and having nothing but burnout and business debt to show for it. My business has now earned more than $82 million in revenue. I've served more than 50,000 students in my online courses, and my podcast, Online Marketing Made Easy, receives over 1 million downloads every month. How? By growing my email list, creating one digital product, rinse and repeat. It's the simple online business cycle I love to teach because it yanks you right out of the virtual content hamster wheel and into the financial abundance that the scale of the internet allows. Want to find out how your experience and expertise fits into the equation? Let's get started. Okay, let's get started. Yeehaw. Okay, so there's a free quiz, a course creation bootcamp, and her new book. I love it. Okay, let's go to her about page. Oh, thank you so much for another super chat. Okay. Wright's Mind is asking, how many life coaches does it take to change a light bulb? One, but the bulb has to really want to change. Oh my God, I love that. I'm saving that one for later. Let me find it in the chat. We're screenshotting that one. That one's going on my Instagram. Okay. Anyway, moving on. The rest of you, I will get back to. I'm snarking right now, though. Okay. How can being your own boss redefine your life? What if I don't want to be my own boss? I mean, personally, I do want to be my own boss, but what if I don't? What if I didn't want to? Then what? For me, it's an 8-figure business, 50,000 students, 49 million podcast downloads, and 32-hour work week. Okay, weird flex. Does that not seem like a weird flex? 32-hour work week? That's so random. Like, has anyone here read 4-Hour Work Week by Tim Ferriss? Literally, I read that book even when I liked personal development stuff. And even at that time, I was like, this book is so out of touch with how most people live. But 32-hour work week, that just seems like that's not a flex. A lot of people only work like 35 hours a week. Like when I had my 9-to-5 job, because of my lunch break, I only got paid for 35 hours a week. Exactly. There's like, isn't 32 hours still full time? Me, I'm like, I'm confused. That's not a flex. So you work a normal job? Cool. Happy for you. Starting an online business so genuinely, drastically, and beautifully changed my life that I became obsessed with shouting how I built an eight-figure business with, oh my God, she just repeats the same thing over and over again. But the leap from overworked corporate yes girl to leading a team of 20 and helping thousands of entrepreneurs create the lives they love didn't happen overnight. That leap was more of a back and forth dance with plenty of humiliating failures and decisions I wasn't sure I would survive. But was it worth it? See for yourself. Okay. In 2009, she got married, which is the best decision she's ever made. In 2009, she also put in her 2 weeks notice and never held a normal job again. Cool. Happy for you. In 2010, I built the wrong business. I traded one corporate boss for 10 clients who are basically bosses. When one screaming client pushed me over the edge, I made a major pivot into the digital course business model I have today. 2011, I flopped. My first digital course launch made $267 and I cried about it. I pulled myself together and reevaluated every last inch of my launch and gave it one more shot. Thank goodness I made 30K and saw the power of digital courses with my own eyes. Okay, but what was the digital course? Does anyone know? Does anyone here follow Amy Porterfield close enough to know what her original course was? Because if it was a course on how to sell courses, I swear to someone, I'm going to punch somebody. 2013, I launched my first podcast. My business, 2013, my business almost earned $1 million. Blah, blah, blah. Then she started a team of people. 2019, I became known for busting the glass ceiling. 2020, all I needed was a laptop to run my business. We moved from California to Tennessee. 2021, my company was listed in the Inc. 5000. 2021, I adopted the four-day work week, just 32 hours. Okay. I wrote my first book. Okay. So I don't know. What was her first course? Okay, I'm coming back to the chat. I'm like, what is happening here? Ay, ay, ay. Okay, 4 days. Sorry, I'm just catching up as always. Yeah, this doesn't make any sense. I'm so confused. Yeah, that's a rare time freedom, 32 hours. I just don't get it. Like, that's not a flex. According to the Wayback Machine, her 2011 course was Facebook marketing. Okay, so she... Oh, something about awards and lists is that you often have to pay to play. Yeah, exactly. The number of times I've been approached to be featured in, like, Forbes 30 under 30 when I was under 30, now Forbes 40 under 40, the up and coming entrepreneurs of 2020, whatever, like all the time, I'll get DMs being like, we can get you on this list, just pay us. I'm like, I'll pass, thanks. Thanks though. Okay, so I'm going to go to Google and I'm going to ask, what was Amy Porterfield's first course? So random. Okay, I'm going to share this tab with you so we can explore together. Also, don't mind the fact that I wrote in all capitals. I have this keyboard that doesn't have a light on it, so I never know when the cap locks is on. Okay, I didn't know what I was doing when I created my first digital course. I rushed to get something into market without figuring out my expertise. My course was about launching a book using social media, which I'd helped people with a bit with, but I'd never done it on my own. Okay, so we're actually going to read the article that she shared in her... Oh, I got to disable my ad blocker. Please hold. Okay, this is the one she shared in her little timeline. Oh my God, so annoying. I don't want to see ads. This is why I have ad blocker on. Okay, blah, 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 blah. Tell us about your background. Here we go. When I tell you that my family was blue collar to the bone, I mean it. Here we go. Rags to riches. Everyone get the freaking tissues out. My dad was a firefighter. My mom worked part-time as a hairstylist. They had a traditional marriage, blah, blah, blah. Okay. I went on to work as a content director for a world-famous motivational speaker for almost 7 years. She worked for Tony Robbins, didn't she? I'm pretty sure someone on Reddit, I have a Reddit thread open that I'm pretty sure says she used to work for Tony Robbins. Although it was a genuinely great experience, I was incredibly unhappy towards the end because I was building someone else's dream. I hit a point where I craved the freedom of creating a life by my own design, more than the comfort and safety of having a boss. Okay, blah, blah, blah. So basically she worked for the king of the grifters, in my opinion. And now she just is a grifter. Okay. Anyway, moving on. Before quitting my job in 2009, I learned everything I could about the online digital space and running launches from beginning to end. There was a tiger in me that roared. In 1 year, I'm going to quit and make this happen for myself. I started my own social media consulting business on the side and slowly built up a clientele until I got the courage to take a leap. When I did, I realized I made my biggest mistake ever. Instead of one boss, I had 8 clients who were basically my bosses. I had stepped right back into the doer role instead of into the leader role. I knew I needed to become the go-to person for something in my industry, but I hadn't found it yet. It all blew up in my face 2 years later when I just got off a plane after attending a marketing conference. One of my worst clients called me while I was on the tarmac trying to juggle my suitcase, cell phone, coffee cup, between the roar of the blah, blah. Why does it have to be so dramatic? The webinar went horrible today. Where were you? Amy, this will never happen again. That was the last straw. I was shaking with dread. My face was hot. Blah, 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 blah. This is so dumb. Okay, what were the biggest challenges you faced? I didn't know what I was doing when I created my first digital course. I rushed to get something to the market without figuring out my expertise. That's because you didn't have any expertise. My course was about launching a book using social media, which I'd helped people a bit with, but I'd never done on my own. Big mistake. I also had no idea who I was marketing to and was trying to figure the whole thing out on my own. I ended up spending several $1,000s creating the course and only made a whopping $247. Okay, my question is, where were you spending all this money? I have created courses before completely for free. In fact, I sell a course right now that I created for free. So I'm very confused as to why you spent thousands of dollars. But anyway, maybe nobody bought it because you didn't know what you were doing. Okay, so now she's all upset. What was the turning point? Here we go. I started to pay really close attention to what my audience needed, reading their comments on my blog, paying attention to their questions and stories, uncovering their fears. Okay, so figuring out who your ideal client was and what problems they actually had. Finally, I began creating a course that would help, that people would actually buy. How to use social media to build your business. So let me get this straight. Let me make myself big again. She launched a course as her business, completely failed at selling that course, but then decided to create a new course teaching people how to build a business using social media, even though she hadn't done that herself. Am I reading this correctly? Can someone please confirm that I'm reading this correctly? Because to me, it's like, well, I tried to start a business doing this one thing, but it didn't work. So instead I started to sell people on the idea that I knew how to build a business. Very, very icky. Yeah. Yes, 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 Hannah. I needed to be the go-to person for something in my industry, but I hadn't found it yet. Sounds so egotistical. 1,000%. I will be the person who knows the most once I know something. I don't know what that something is yet, but I'm going to figure it out. Yeah, okay, Natalie, this is a complete sidetrack, but I get emails from this place all the time. And in the emails, they make it look like you signed up. They're like, hey, we finished processing your application. Click here to pay. And then I clicked on it and I was like, I didn't sign up for this. She's saying, if you ever come across something called the Worldwide Women's Association, do not join it. It's a scam. Okay. Sorry, I'm just catching up on the comments. Here we go. All people have to do is read the disclaimers on the bottom. Hers literally states that the information provided is not a substitute for professional advice. Stop! Does it show me screenshots? I want to see. That's so wild. Oh my god. Okay, everyone else is reading it the same. Perfect, perfect. Life stories, just make it up. Want to be an expert in something? Just decide you're the expert, guys. That's the secret. Oh my god, I hate this. Yes, looks like she didn't have an unbiased editor, because if someone outside the circle read this, they'd have to add information or details. 100% correct. I would have a few questions to ask if I was reading this as the editor. Not that I have any skills in editing. Okay. Let's continue. I just had to clarify. I feel like I should just leave it in this view, because otherwise we're just looking at ads anyway, so you might as well look at my face, okay? Okay, then came the confidence boost when I started hearing stories from my students. The first time I heard your program helped me quit my job and start my own business, I was hooked. As money started flowing in, I realized that if I could do this, other women could too, of course. Quickly, I made the decision that I would go first. I would build this business, make mistakes, and share them along the way so that I could be an example. Oh my God, Amy, you are such a savior for all of us. How brave of you to finally do that for me, because I could absolutely never. So thank you. I'm going to cry. As money started flowing in, I realized that if I could do this, oh, blah, 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 blah. Since then, I've faced big challenges along the way, including 2 failed launches, a misguided marketing decision that cost me a whopping $20,000 when you made $10 million. Boo freaking who? Sorry. The heartbreak of entering into a partnership that turned out to be wrong for me. Who was it? Who did she partner with? Did she partner with Rachel Hollis? Someone in the chat, please confirm. Who is this botched partnership? blah, 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 blah. They can blast right through the glass ceiling and make as much money as they want. Okay, yeah, this is brutal. I'm like bored just reading this. It's hurting my brain. Many entrepreneurs today are talking about online courses. What makes your approach different? One of the biggest mistakes that course creators make is to throw everything they know at their students and overwhelm them. Instead of quantity, my program focuses on quality. I teach exactly what my students need to know. No fluff, no extra, because nobody has time for that. Ugh. Speed sets me apart too. I show people how to create a roadmap to teach their students. I show them how to take out all the fluff and get people from point A to point B as fast as possible. You know where else you can learn that? Google. Just saying. I also genuinely care about my students, blah, blah, blah. If you're not intentional about getting course buyers from A to B, they probably won't arrive there. Okay, whatever. Oh, God. Oh, this is hurting my brain. I don't even want to read this. It's making me angry. Okay, stop sharing. We're done. That was a waste of our time. I'm sorry, everyone. Okay, let me just see. Peer reviewing others' work, like 8th grade lit class, is also helpful. But doesn't look like that happened here. Absolutely not. I mean, it's Forbes, though. Are we surprised? I feel like Forbes has really gone downhill. Please don't sue me. Allegedly. Just based on, like, the types of people they feature in their articles and stuff. I'm like, did you not do your research to figure out that this person's a scammer? Not saying like Amy Porterfield specifically. There are just other entrepreneurs. There's one in particular who's very big in the coaches space. And I'm just like, why are you? Okay, sure, she's a 25-year-old that has made $50 million, but like, is she doing it ethically? Why are you platforming her? I'm confused. Oh, I hate it here. Okay. So we want to know, who did Amy Porterfield go into a partnership with that failed? By we, I mean me. That's what I want to know. Was it Rachel Hollis? Somebody help. Whoops, sorry. I'm clicking on wild comments. So many things are happening. Yeah, We Sweet Goth, I feel the same way. That's why I had to speed through that article and stop reading, because my brain is literally melting out of my head. And if I kept reading, you guys would see things you don't want to see. Well, showing it was a waste was also helpful. Okay, I'm glad. I'm glad we took something away from it. Yeah, this is how I feel as well. I feel as though allegedly, possibly in my opinion, people are just buying their way into Forbes to like enhance their legitimacy, when the reality is it's like, whatever. Actually, in what I have heard allegedly again from other people that I know, possibly in my opinion, is that a lot of the stuff that's featured on like the Forbes website are, I don't know the term because I'm not a journalist, where like people who don't necessarily work for Forbes, but they're like freelance writers, can write pieces that get featured in Forbes. Writes Mind, if you're here, let me know what that's called. And so basically it's like, if I know someone who is a writer that freelance writes for Forbes, they could write an article about me and then submit it to be like featured on the Forbes website. So yeah, it's just kind of whatever. In my opinion, allegedly, is how I feel. Okay. Anyways, moving on. That was weird. Where were we before all of that? Oh, we were looking at the timeline on her website. Okay, I just want to show you guys this, because when I saw this, I laughed out loud so hard. I LOL'd so hard at this quote that she has featured on her website. Amy does a remarkable job breaking down the steps for creating a passion-filled life and business, from none other than another queen grifter, Mel Robbins, in my opinion, allegedly, based on my own opinion. Yes. Okay. Sorry, I just had to show you all that because I thought it was great. It's like, okay, how can I, in my tiny little network of people who are in my echo chamber and believe the same things I do, use them to promote myself? Okay, hello, Jackie. Jackie says, just here at the beginning of the live, listening while I drink my President's Choice Blue Label Lime Bubbly Water. Are we the same person? Well, mine isn't lime, but I have the President's Choice Blue Menu Calamansi Citrus Strawberry. If you haven't seen this flavor in your local grocery store, run, don't walk. It's really good. I buy this one a lot, and President's Choice, not Blue Menu, but they have like the PC brand orange cream soda or something like that it's called, but it's the soda water, like orange soda flavored sparkling water. So good. It tastes like a cream soda, or not a cream soda, a creamsicle. Those popsicles that are like orange on the outside and ice cream in the middle. It tastes like that, but obviously no sugar. Oh my God. So freaking good. Sorry. Tangent. For all the Americans, I'm sorry to be boring you, but we don't have Trader Joe's here. We have President's Choice. Forbes first introduced its contributing writer. Okay, that's what I was looking for. So yeah, like if you were a contributing writer, I could just be like, hey, Rebecca, write an article about me. And you'd be like, okay. Like, it's just, I hate it. Okay. I'm done cooking. You have my undivided attention. Honestly, Alexis, that's how I watch most of my YouTube, is while I'm doing something else. Today, we baked our own brioche buns. It's pioneer season over at my house. So buckle up, because we're going to get into some good eats. I made cinnamon buns last weekend. This weekend was brioche buns. What's next? I don't know. I'm kind of in the mood to make some focaccia. Is that what it's called? The one where you like poke your fingers in it? I think that's what's going to be next. Janaea, everything is in my opinion, allegedly, possibly, from what I read in my opinion on the internet with my own eyes, based on my experiences. Birds of a feather grift together. We love it. Okay. Sorry. I'm like so all over the place right now. Yes. I should message Maggie. She probably knows. Maggie and I are Instagram friends. If you're not following Maggie Peters on Instagram, you absolutely should. She talks a lot about like no BS business. A lot of the same stuff as I do. Coaching, coaches, coaches, coaching, coaching. You know what I'm saying. I'll message her and ask if she knows. okay. Lindsay, yes. Lindsay wants to try. I saw it in Vancouver when I had no cans. Honestly, so I moved recently. And the grocery store I go to now has a way better selection of sparkling water than the one I used to go to. The one I used to go to would only ever have lime. This one has every flavor you could imagine. Even the pomegranate blueberry, which I don't see very often. That one's pretty good too. Okay, so sorry. Okay, yeah, focaccia is the one you poke your fingers in. Thanks for clearing that up. Anyway, moving on. The people who are here for the Amy Porterfield info are like, Danielle, go, like, shut up. Shut up and give me the information I want to see. And you know what I have to say to that? How about no? Yeah. Yeah, I used to shop at a No Frills, but it was like a very barren No Frills. It was not very good. But I mean, they're also different. I guess it's based on like the demographic of people that live in the area, maybe. So then they only stock like what people will buy. Exactly. We ain't out here trying to get sued. Every time I do a live stream, my partner's like, okay, but don't get us into a lawsuit. I'm like, I will try my best, allegedly, in my opinion, from what I know, based on stuff that I read on the internet that might not be true, but is my opinion. Okay, so we've looked at her website. We looked at her news article. I guess we can go to her Instagram. So let me pull that up here. Can you guys see that? Okay, let me see if I can. How's that? Okay. So this is her Instagram. It says she has 377,000 followers. Happy for you. A little bit jealous, TBPH. Online marketing educator. Okay, let's turn this into a Instagram marketing 101. So as someone who works in social media, I help clients with their social media. Number one tip for you, don't do this. If you are trying to build a business, either whether it's a service-based business, a product-based business, doesn't matter. Even though her handle is her name should also be in the headline. So basically, Instagram, like every other platform these days, wants to operate as a search engine. In order to do so, you need to make sure you are searchable. So this should say Amy, then have a line, and then say online marketing educator. I'm being finicky, but I'm just letting you know, if you want to improve your search social media, you watching this video right now, that's one thing you can do. Change it to your name, a line, and then what it is you do, so that people who are searching for those terms are going to be able to find you. So she would actually be better off instead of saying online marketing educator. I mean, I guess, because if someone searches online marketing, it'll come up. But yeah, just a fun fact. Anyway, moving on. Put a bubble on the screen with words. Oh, smart. I should do that. I have the option to do like these like overlay things like this. I don't know if that worked. Yeah, like the little border. I could do one that says that. That's a really good idea. Thank you so much for sharing that. I appreciate that. I'm going to do that for sure. Educator is just a scam school teacher. Actually, so I want to make a comment about this because my partner and I were commenting the other day how every single like grifter that we know, because we both kind of run in like the entrepreneurial circle, there are people we know in the real world who are kind of in this like griftier space. They do some shady stuff. Every one of these people has entrepreneur as their like profile identifier. And we were commenting to each other how no one we know who is an actual entrepreneur, myself, my partner, for example, any of our friends, other friends who own businesses, none of them would have entrepreneur as their like classifier. So again, with Instagram, if you have a creator or a business account, you can classify your profile. So mine says digital creator, I think. No one we know who is a real entrepreneur would have entrepreneur, because you don't need to identify the fact that you are an entrepreneur, I guess is kind of my point. Exactly. So entrepreneur is kind of a red flag now. To me, it's like the people who have to identify themselves as an entrepreneur are doing it to make up for the fact that they come off as like skeezy, or it's not really clear what it is they do. So when I introduce myself to people that I don't know, if I'm at like a networking event, for example, I would introduce myself as a content marketer. I'm a marketer. I'm a content creator and a marketer. Those are the things that I specialize in. Yeah, I'm self-employed, but I wouldn't be like, I'm an entrepreneur. Okay, but like, what do you do? Like, you know? Exactly. Hannah saying no entrepreneur really ever calls themselves that. Exactly. And so my partner and I joke about this a lot, just because it's like, it's so weird to us that all of these people who have either been in business for 5 minutes or never really had a successful business, all of a sudden market themselves as entrepreneurs and experts on entrepreneurship. And they start making all of these promises on these specific outputs that aren't realistic. It's just like red flag, red flag, red flag. Yes, very, very true. So this comment says, if it's like if a nice person tells you they're a nice person, they're probably the farthest thing from it. 100%. Same vibes. Anyways, that was a tangent. So yeah, so Instagram class 101, your headline should have your name and then a line and then what it is you do. And then this bio is all about her. So she's saying, I'm a New York Times bestselling author. This is the name of my book, available now. DM me bootcamp to join Course Confident. If I come to her profile, I'm like all over the place. I'm turning this into a marketing lesson. Your Instagram profile should always be created or like displayed under the assumption that no one has any idea who you are or what you do. So when someone comes to your profile and they read through it, it becomes very clear whether or not your content is going to be relevant to them. And I would say the majority of people who are new to your profile don't make it past your bio, especially if it's bad. So again, hers doesn't say anything. If I came to her profile, I didn't know who she was. I see, okay, she's an online marketing educator. What does that really mean? There's nothing here that indicates whether or not this bootcamp is good for me. It doesn't, like, what do you help me do? What would be more effective would be if she had a line that said, I help small businesses build their business on social media. Obviously, you would word that a little bit better. I'm not a copywriter, but you get what I mean. I help X do Y. Like, this doesn't tell me anything. So they're all New York Times bestselling authors. So that means nothing to me, in my opinion. But I'm just saying, like, this means nothing. I don't know what you help me do. Why would I DM you bootcamp? Like, what is that going to do? What is that going to do for me? Ugh. Yes, exactly. So many people my friends follow and adore have entrepreneur in their profiles, but have zero idea what field they're in. Exactly. Okay. Anyways, so that was an aside. So if you're here, and again, you're a service-based, product-based business, we talked about the headline already, but your bio should be very clear who you are, who you help, and then how people can get in touch. So I have nothing wrong with a call to action, but the call to action here isn't really clear. It doesn't really tell me what you're doing. Like my call to action literally says, grab a free business checklist or something like that. It's like very clear who it's going to help. Grifterpreneur. I love it. That's great. Grifterpreneur. Hoo-hoo-hoo. Exactly, Hannah. This is my point. Hannah's saying, how do I know if I want to join Course Confident if I don't know what Course Confident is? Exactly. What would be more effective here would be for me to speak proper English, would be, again, I help small business owners market their business online. And then this should be like, DM me bootcamp if you want to build your business on social media or something like that. Like something more clear as to what I'm going to get out of this. Anyway, I don't want to bore you all with my marketing know-how. But if you ever have any questions, DM me. Let's chat about it. It is really disturbing how many sketchy money grabs there are out there and how much they disguise themselves as legitimate opportunities. I think to me, that's the scariest part. As someone who has fallen prey to many of these different like opportunities over the course of my time as an entrepreneur, because if you didn't know, I'm an entrepreneur and my whole personality is owning my own business. I say that, but my personality kind of is that. Anyway, as someone who has fallen prey to a lot of these, like learn how to build your business opportunities, I will say that when you are just starting out, it is very easy to become susceptible to these because you can't tell, you don't know. Exactly. No wonder people get scammed so easily. These are wild. So they make them sound like the perfect opportunity, exactly what you need. A lot of the copy speaks like directly to your pain points. And then next thing you know, rip, you're out all this money. Okay, let's see. Let's look through some of her content. I wonder how much my digital course students have made. 100 income claims. Okay, so this is actually something funny that came up in the DMs today. Someone was asking me like, hey, Danielle, do you know the stats on like how much money the average life or business coach makes? And I'm like, well, I don't, because that they're all their own individual businesses. And the only person most of them are responsible for reporting their income to is the government. Like if I was a life coach, at least here in Canada, I don't have to like publicly say how much money I made. I just file my taxes and let the government know. So there's no like clear stats. Whereas when you're with like an MLM company, the MLM has to report the income, right? So when course creators like this are making these income claims, it's like, okay, but did they actually make that much money? There's no way to know whether or not they did or didn't because there's no structure for reporting. Exactly. She should write, I sell a course on how to sell a course, but then nobody will click. Yeah, exactly. Okay, so let's read the caption. The caption says, comment course to join me for my Course Confidence Bootcamp and take the first steps to becoming the next success story. Having my own success as a course creator is definitely amazing, but seeing your success and the success of my students, now that is my literal mission. If creating courses has worked for so many of my students, I'm willing to bet it's going to work for you too. Learn what's possible in creating your own digital course inside my bootcamp, comment course, and I'll send a link to your DMs. Da, 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 da. So what I'm gathering is Amy Porterfield allegedly built her empire by creating a course, teaching people how to create a course. Other coaches in my circle recommended her, quoted her in their emails. I wonder if she has an affiliate program where, like, if I refer people into her course, I wonder if I would get a commission. Anyway, that's an aside. I know Marie Forleo does that with B School. If you refer people into B School, you get like $1,000 commission or something. Ugh. Okay, Ray says, preying on young and vulnerable people trying to find their way in the world. College costs are astronomical, and this seems so much fun. Plus, lots of money for little work. Great point. We should actually talk about this. So a lot of the times, comments I will get and I agree with will say things like, oh, that like coaching course costs more than a semester tuition at university or whatever. Like, so here in Canada, I don't know. I went to school a long time ago, like 10 years ago. But I think my tuition was like $4,000 a semester or something. I know Canada, I think, is much less expensive than the US. But anyway, so let's just say I spent $4,000 a semester. So that's what, $8,000 a year. The coaching program I signed up for was $4,500, the first one I signed up for. So that's more than my semester tuition. And so Ray's saying here, lots of money for a little work in terms of like what you'll get out of the program. And this seems so much more fun. So when I hired my coach, she was promising me all of these specific deliverables of like the outcomes that I'm going to achieve if I work with her. And it was very, very enticing, which is what made it so easy for me to sign up and give her that money. Because, well, why would I work a job that I don't like, that I used my college diploma to, or like my university degree to get, when I could just pay you $4,500 and you're going to teach me all the secrets I need to build my own success in my own life on my own terms? It is very, very flashy and exciting, especially when you are in a place where you're not happy with your current reality. Preying on vulnerabilities. We hate it here. The company Ula is the ultimate course MLM. I actually just got told about a new MLM. I think this is what it's called. Yeah, it's called the IYO Club, and it is a, I'll share the tab. I think I'm going to do a full video on this, so I'm not going to get like too into this right now, but I'll just show you guys quickly. It's like a course membership. So they like, you sign up and then kind of like it ties into the MRR thing. If you haven't seen my MRR video, Master Resale Rights, you should go and watch that. But it's this idea that you like sign up and then you recruit other people to build courses. And then you're all just like building courses on top of each other. I don't know. I don't really get it. But again, I think I'm going to do like a whole deep dive video on them. Somebody sent it to me after I did my MRR video and was like, Danielle, you need to look at this and I need to send you the compensation plan because it makes no sense. So I am intending to get to that, but I will look into this Ula one as well. So CE is saying, I wonder if she offers financing. She could make some extra income on charges. I'm going to guess. Let's go to her website. I think she probably does offer a payment plan. I went on a little bit of a rant earlier about payment plans, if you missed that. But most of these people offer payment plans at an upsell. So like if the course is $1,000, the payment plan might be, you know, three payments of $400 or something. Let's see. Okay, so if I sign up for this course, yeah, so you can either make three monthly payments of $179 or one-time payment of $500. So what's three times $179? So that ends up costing $537. So it's like an extra $40 if you take the payment plan, which, again, because of the demographic that these people target, most people need a payment plan because not everyone can afford to pay $500 out of pocket. So it's like you're literally taking advantage of people that you're already taking advantage of. You're double taking advantage of them. I hate it. It's so icky. Icky, icky, icky. We don't like it here. Exactly. The scam within the scam. Let's see. Okay. So here's the thing. It's like, again, I've said this so many times, but if I had no moral compass, I didn't operate within any sort of ethical boundaries, I think I could be a really good grifter because I really understand how these scams work. But the piece for me is like, Okay, if I'm going to create a program that I kind of know is like taking advantage of vulnerable people, like I'm making promises that I probably can't deliver on, that's one thing. But then to also be like, but how can I take even more advantage of these people? I'm going to charge them more money for being poor. To me, it's like, how do you sleep at night? That's what I want to know. How do the exactly morals, what are they? I don't know. They're gone. Bye-bye. Yeah, exactly. It's just one giant downline. I hate it so bad. Yes, please give the stream a thumbs up or a thumbs down. You know, both help. So if you hate me, good for you. I had someone comment on one of my videos the other day being like, oh my God, I wish I could give this video a thumbs down. Blah, 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 blah. Then they went on this big rant about why they hated the video, which is fine. But I wanted to comment and be like, you can do give me a thumbs down. You can dislike this video. There's literally a thing that looks like this. And if you click it, that'll tell me you don't like my video. It gave me a good laugh anyway. They were very upset. Like they wrote me like a 4-paragraph thing about why my video was so incorrect. So really happy for them. I hope that they sort out whatever was going on there that made them so angry. I see. I've only ever financed a car at 0%. I mean, this was back before the interest rates went crazy, but in Canada at least, before the prime interest is now like something stupid. Back in my day, you used to be able to finance vehicles at 0%. So you weren't punished for being poor. But it would depend. You have to have good credit, obviously, and only if you did it over like a certain term. But yeah, I get what you're saying. But it's still, it just seems icky to me. Marie is saying, I'm generally okay with paying a bit extra for a payment plan, but more like an extra $10. Interesting. Yes. Yeah. I mean, it's kind of, I think it depends on the price of the product. And I understand there's liability when people take a payment plan, they might default on their payments. But I don't know, just revoke access then if you're concerned that people are going to like steal the product and not, you're not going to get the money. Yeah, that was the funny part was that they were so upset and their whole comment was like why they hated the video. But they started it by saying, I wish I could give this video a dislike. And I'm like, I literally actually in that video that they commented on, because I went and rewatched the intro, I literally said, give this video a thumbs up. Unless you hate it, then give it a thumbs down. And the person still couldn't give the thumbs down. Anyway, I'm too fixated on that, but I just thought it was really funny. Okay. These courses selling to others really are the ultimate pyramid scheme. No regulation to actually produce a quality course that's equivalent to what is charged. Exactly. No regulation and no clear framework under which to evaluate how to price your products or services. So I feel like in most or many industries, there's kind of like an industry standard, like here in Canada. If you want to go to therapy, it's generally priced around $100 to $150 an hour. That's like kind of to be expected. If you're going to go get a 60-minute massage, that's probably going to cost you about $120. If you're going to get, I don't know, your go get a pedicure, that's going to be anywhere from like $60 to $90, depending like where you live. Again, kind of like a general standard. Like, if someone was like, hey, Danielle, do you want to come with me to get a pedicure? It's going to be $250. I would be like, absolutely not. I can go to this other lady down the street where it's $75. In the coaching industry, there's no standards. You have one coach that'll charge $100 an hour and then another coach that'll charge $100,000 an hour. It's literally so obscure and just like everyone is just doing so many different things. That it's a little bit scary, honestly, because if you come into a particular like section of the coaching industry not knowing any better, you might think that this is the standard. Like, oh, these courses just cost $1,000. Like, I remember watching, again, that very first webinar that I ever watched, not realizing it was pre-recorded, thinking she was selling a course on how to sell a course, and it was $1,000. I very clearly remember because I almost purchased it. I was like, oh, this is the standard because she's offering all of these bonuses that are worth up to $20,000. Like, I'm getting a good deal now and I need to buy it right now. And I'm going to get, you know, $1,000 back, so it'll be fine. But it's like, little do you know, you don't know what you don't know. So somebody else on Udemy could sell a course on how to create a course for $20. Like, yeah, it's just icky. Yeah, exactly. Back in my day. And yes, in 2016, I financed my first car at 0%. And at that point in time, it was common. Obviously not now because the interest rate in Canada is like so high that 0% interest isn't a thing anymore. But yes, very true. I also think it's like way different in the States than in Canada. Like I watch a lot of Caleb Hammer, if you guys are familiar here on YouTube. And all the interest rates these people share when they're like talking about their car payments and stuff, I'm like, unless you finance, at least again, in my experience through like what I know of car dealerships in Canada, unless you finance through like one of those private loan vendors, then your interest rate's like 20 or 30%. Most car loans, again, before the interest rates went crazy, you could finance around like 5.99 would be like an average, I would say. But these people are always like, my car payment's at 14% interest. I'm like, I would walk. I would buy a bicycle. I'm not financing a car at 15%. Anyway, sorry. I only put large purchases on plans. Exactly. Like if you're buying a car or a mortgage, then it makes sense to finance. My philosophy, Ray, is similar. And obviously this comes from like a position of privilege, but if I can't afford it in cash, I usually won't buy it. I will just save up until I have the money to buy whatever it is I want at that price point. Except obviously like a house or a car, because if only I were rich enough to afford either of those in cash, maybe one day when I become a millionaire, when we all become millionaires, let's manifest it, baby. Anyway, you don't have nice music for thumbs down. Yeah, I need to invest in one of those soundboards where I can, like DC has or Kia, any of them. One day we'll get there. Rosie Posey's advice for all of you is that if you find a $10 pedicure, you should probably stay away. Absolutely. We're not looking to get foot fungus here. Okay, sorry. I'm so far behind in the comments. I'm gonna have to skip through some of this. Okay. This one says, expensive clients give you less headaches, so overvalue yourself to save the headache instead of matching the value of your rate. What? Oh, expensive clients give you less headaches, so overvalue yourself to save the headache. Okay. I agree and disagree. I do I've had bad experiences with clients on all ends of the spectrum. So I have mixed opinions about that. Okay, sorry, I'm just catching up. People in the US that buy cars need to commute, honestly. Yeah, exactly. That was my point too, Ray. It's like, I have the ability to very thankfully be able to, you know, afford my bills and all of that. So when I want to make a large purchase, I will just wait until I have the money in cash. But obviously that's not an option for everyone, unfortunately, in this economic climate that we live in. I feel ya. Okay. Yeah, that's kind of what I figured now. So we have a friend who just bought a new car and he's at 9% because the base interest rate is really high. Like, what is the Bank of Canada interest rate is 5%, and it was at 0% for years. So basically it's like the Bank of Canada charges 5%, but then the bank through which you finance is able to tack on like their percentage as well. So even like, so I have a line of credit, I don't use it, but I still like have it open. And when I first got that line of credit, it was prime plus 3.5%. So if I bought something on it, I would get charged 3.5%. But now because prime is 5%, anything I buy on that line of credit would be charged at 8.5%. So it's pretty wild the difference that the raising of prime makes. I'm financing my car last year at 6.75. Exactly. Yeah. So that 9%, if that person had have purchased that car like 2 years ago, back when prime was still zero, it would have been at 4% versus 9%. Anyway, this isn't a math lesson. I'm not a financial advisor. Don't come to me for financial advice, but... It's wild when I take home in states without income tax. Oh, like if you compare. Yeah, because some states, like, I don't remember which ones. Like, California has really high state income tax from what I've heard. It's like the highest. In Canada, it varies a little bit province to province, but there's no province that doesn't have provincial income tax. Alberta doesn't have provincial sales tax, so if you go like shopping in Alberta, you only have to pay federal sales tax. But as far as I know, there's still provincial income tax in Alberta. Anyway, I don't know how we got here, everyone. I'm sorry. I don't know how 56 of you are still here watching. If you're on the replay, I'm sorry. We're just like talking about finances now. Welcome to my new podcast called How to Get Rich. Yeah, I don't even want to think about how much vehicles cost. Like I said, I purchased my car in 2016 for $23,000 Canadian, mind you. So that's like 17 grand, probably US. And then I sold it when I moved across the country for, so I paid it off. I bought it in 2016 on a 5-year payment plan. I paid it off in 2021. In 2022, I sold it for $10,000. So I basically drove a brand new car off the lot for 6 years for $12,000, which is just wild to think about. And now like my partner has a car that he bought in cash. It was used years and years ago. And we're just like, oh my God, I pray that this thing lasts a few more years because I don't even want to think about buying a new car right now. It's so expensive. Yeah. So, We Sweet Goth in Canada, it's the same. Like if you work a normal job, you're a normal job. If you work a disgusting, gross 9-to-5, ew, loser job, your pay will have your income tax deducted. But it varies depending on like which province you live in, how much income tax gets deducted, if that makes sense. Exactly. They lure people in with dreams of money, but no talk of managing finance. Absolutely agree. I actually, this is like a complete tangent, but I've been wanting to talk about this on the internet, but I don't want to like specifically out this individual because I think she's just like a confused millennial that doesn't know what she's doing with her life. But there was a woman who went viral on TikTok a couple of years ago, branding herself as like, I'm not going to use the name she uses because it'll be very easy to figure out who she is. But she basically branded herself on the idea of like quitting your 9-to-5 and doing whatever you want. And so she did that. She built a decent following on TikTok, like talking about how she was quitting her job to like build her own dream life. And she started like coaching other people to quit their jobs and this kind of thing. And she wasn't really coaching them on starting a business so much as just like quit your 9-to-5 job and like build a life that you want, which is kind of fluffy and is very kind of similar to the stuff I used to coach people on, if I'm being honest, although I never told anyone to quit their job. Mostly just like the passion, like follow your passions. So she was coaching people to quit their jobs and follow their passion. Then it comes out an entire year later, she makes another TikTok after she like consistently is creating content around like the whole persona of quitting your job. Turns out she's $60,000 in debt because she quit her job without a plan and wasn't able to like build anything significant enough to pay her bills. Ended up having to like move back in with her parents. She took out all this debt to pay her, or no, she had moved out of her parents, got an apartment, used all this debt to pay her bills, but on social media was selling this idea of being a 9-to-5 quitter, quit your job and build your dream life. And now she's $60,000 in debt and has to like figure out how she's going to make that money. And I'm just like, why are you selling people on a dream that has caused you to be in such a horrible financial situation? You're going to ruin people's lives, for lack of a better term, if you're going around convincing people to quit their jobs without a backup plan. When I quit my 9-to-5 job, I swallowed my pride and got a part-time job at a golf course working as a bartender so that I could have money to pay my rent while I started to build my business, because I knew that just like quitting my 9-to-5 job and hoping that my business took off was not a realistic strategy when I'm an adult with plan, like with bills to pay. So it's like, this whole idea of just do whatever you want and believe you're going to achieve your dreams. No, absolutely don't. Have a backup plan. Okay, I knew there were states that had no income tax. So no income tax, but is there sales tax in South Dakota? Let me know. As we're having tax talk. Yeah, exactly, Lindsay. That's how I feel. We want to get a hybrid Jeep, like the ones that are like half electric, half gas, just because we do a lot of like remote camping. So we want something with 4x4 that can get us down some sketchy roads, but we also don't want to be like stranded with an EV out in the middle of nowhere. So we want the option to have both, but the prices right now and the building we live in isn't retrofitted with chargers and stuff. It's so complex. We were on a walk today and there was so many houses, like I'm not even joking, there was like 4 houses in a row where people were running extension cords from their house over the sidewalk to charge their cars. So funny. Oh my god. Anyway, sorry, I am so far behind on the comments as always. Who is that, the person who was on? No, so this person wasn't on Caleb Hammer. This person was just someone that I follow on TikTok who was very vocal it was around like 2021, 2022 about quit your job, da 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 da. And then a year later comes out like, oh, I'm actually in so much debt. But yeah, I'm sure there's lots of people like that. Exactly. We Sweet God says, let that be a lesson to you. Stay away from the coaches that coach coaches. You can't have it all with no job. Exactly. If it sounds too good to be true, it probably is. Just like I always say, her plan was to get everyone to buy her course, and I guess not enough people bought it. Because then, so this was probably like 6 months ago that she came out and said like, oh, I'm actually $60,000 in debt. So now her whole personality is like, let me show you me how I'm going to get out of debt. And she did a breakdown of where her like income sources were, and she only made like $4,000 from coaching people. So it's like, so you tried to start a coaching business and you failed, but you still wanted to sell people on the dream. It's not even space pastry. I would disagree that it's not even that it's too saturated. Like, yes, it is too saturated. It's just unethical. Don't go into coaching because it's really hard to operate from a place of ethics in this current climate and iteration of the coaching industry. Exactly. Unless you're in a trust fund situation, most of us need to work to pay the bills. Exactly. Now she'll sell the life of how she got out of debt. Let me see. We Sweet Goth is asking if she got out of debt. I'm going to look it up. Oh, my dad is texting me. Oh, God. Sorry about that. I'm going to get copyright striked for that one. Okay, what's her name? Let me see. I had to mute her for a while because she kept coming up in my profile or in my feed, and she was just really annoying. Okay, this was a week ago. Okay, let's see. 2 years ago to this day, I quit my job. Wait. 2 years ago to this day, everything changed my life. 2 years ago, I went mega viral. And all of a sudden, I was like, oh, like, people listen to what I have to say. And there's something that's a message here to share. Completely derailed everything, changed my life for the better. But also, for those of you who remember, for a while, it's been a shit show. And I don't want to say shit show, because in the shit show, there were so many good. But also, it's been a lot. So it's so cool today to see how I'm ending the summer. Sorry, I'm like watching the video and then reading it to you if it sounds like I'm a robot. I'm going to Austin soon. Like, all these things are clicking into place. And I just can't help but think my creative recovery is almost over. And the getting reacquainted with my family and spending time with people I love and care about. And just like seeing my hometown in New York in a different perspective. Setting me up so perfectly for this next chapter. I was on the phone with my really good friend, Blank, who was also in Austin. And we both feel the same thing energetically. And I've been saying it for a while too. Shit is about to go down, and I don't know how it's going to happen. I don't know. I like, real as of today, all the things that I want, all the things I'm creating are so out of reach, and yet I don't feel stressed about it. So you're living in delusion. For whatever reason, it's almost like I want to laugh, because I'm like, we don't know how we're going to get there, but it's going to happen soon. She sounds like a manifestation girly. And the reason why I also say that is because a video 2 years ago changed my life. And that literally happened like a few hours ago. Everything happened so quickly in a matter of months. And so the same shit is about to happen right now. Maybe not in the same way, the same timeline. But to go from August 30th to 127 to then December 1st, when I have my New York Times article and everything blew up, 3 to 4 months is not a lot of time. Okay, so when she originally blew up, her TikTok went viral in August, and then she was featured in New York Times in December of that year. I'm also much smarter, and I know what I'm doing this time. So I don't know. I feel good. We're getting back into physically painting right now. I have my iPad and all the things, but I just, like, horses out of the gate. We're ready to run. Okay, so I guess she went mega viral, got featured in New York Times, kind of flopped, went into all this debt, and is now feeling like she's in a revival. I mean, good for her. I hope it works out. But I don't think she's out of debt yet. She's living back at home with her parents, which, nothing wrong with that. If you need to save money, awesome. I lived with my mom until I was like 25 because I needed to save that cash. So anyway. Sorry, I'm like, this live stream is all over the place, so I appreciate you all for sticking it out. If she got out, yeah, I don't have faith that she's out of the coaching industry. I feel like, if anything, she's gonna just like relaunch even deeper in it, based on that TikTok I just transcribed for all of you. Exactly. She hasn't got out. She's just coming up with a new grift. I'll keep my tabs on her, though, just in case she comes to her senses. Yeah, that was Caleb Hammer. So that's the one somebody might be talking about. Kia featured her on her channel, but he interviewed. And if you go to Caleb Hammer's profile, it's like the first video that pops up. But basically, so if you're not familiar, Caleb Hammer, you'll go onto his show as like an interview, and he'll like analyze your finances. It's called Financial Audit. And so basically this like spiritual life coach came on and was like very vague about how much money she's making. I would almost, in my opinion, say that she lied about how much money she was making. But anyways, he basically like reviews her finances, and she is spending so much money on debt, but refuses to change her lifestyle, which is the story of a lot of people that get interviewed on his channel. But it was very, very interesting. I would definitely recommend you watch it. Exactly. She believed that if she spent money on expensive stuff, she'd eventually get the money back. And this is something that is sort of taught in the coaching space, is like, you have to invest in yourself in order to grow to that next level of your business. And while, yes, there are costs associated with running a business, the idea that you have to spend like thousands and thousands of dollars isn't necessarily true. Exactly. Everyone fails in their rags to riches stories, in their course selling ads, how she found this new system, and you can do it too. And that's what it's going to be. I quit my job to start a business and my business failed and I ended up $60,000 in debt. And now I'm so successful. Buy from me. Exactly. Sometimes when you try to sell shovels in a gold rush, you just dig yourself into a deeper hole. Exactly. Yeah, it's pretty rough, honestly. And there are people that I know in my personal life that I've like alluded to in videos that I've done where it's just like, it's really sad to see people get so like indoctrinated, for lack of a better term, into the industry. It's like, there were certain things when I was in coaching where I would be like, ooh, that seems weird, or like, ooh, I don't really want to do that. But then to see people who I genuinely know as good people in the real world, then participating in some of those tactics, to me, it's just like, what switch flipped in your brain where you were like, oh yeah, this is okay, this is normal, I'm just going to go ahead and do it. That's the part that's like a little unsettling for me, because I'm just like, I don't get it. I cannot relate. Oh, I just realized my light. When did my light bulb go out? Somebody tell me. I gotta yell at Google. I'm gonna mute my mic for a second. There it is. Okay. Anyway. Okay. So we're about an hour and 40 minutes in. Haven't really done anything that I intended. So sorry about that. I have some Reddit threads we could read about Amy Porter. I have, oh, that video is 40 minutes. So we're probably not going to watch that. Let's go ahead and read Reddit for 20 minutes or so, and then we'll call it a day. Again, DC and I are going live in about an hour and 20 minutes. So if you don't get enough of me now, come and join me later. Anyway. I feel like I've been talking so much. I apologize. I don't even know what we're doing here. Hannah says, love a good Reddit snoop. Perfect, because that's what we're doing next. If I can figure out how to work my computer, because I'm a boomer. Sometimes it feels like it. Okay. Oh, no. Oh, no, 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 no. Okay. Anyway. Let's see. Okay. Is there a way for me to... I wish I could. Ah! Hold on. Sorry, I'm just trying to figure out how the internet works. So maybe that's better. There we go. I think that's good. Okay. Okay. Sorry, my brain just stopped working for a second. Let's read. Amy Porterfield used to work for Tony Robbins, quit her job, and became a successful entrepreneur. Rachel Hollis is or was one of her closest friends. Used to speak at her events. Gabby on this past week. It's like one large web with Tony the main spider and all of his little peons gathered in the web. I would have to agree with this sentiment. Oh, I'm being hidden by the subscribe button. Oh, I don't think I can. What's about this? Is that better? Boo! Tomato, tomato, tomato. Yeah, okay. So I've chatted with some people that I've interviewed on my channel before, and we've discussed the actual pyramid of these coaches who coach coaches. And Tony Robbins is very much at the top of the pyramid. Obviously, Tony Robbins was coached by Jim Rohn, but I don't care. Tony Robbins is at the top in my eye. Let's see. So this is in the Hollis Uncensored Reddit subreddit. So anyways. It's like a self-help guru MLM with Tony at the top. Exactly. The number one comment I get on any of my content, whether it's here on YouTube, over on Instagram, TikTok, it doesn't matter. It's, this sounds a lot like MLM, or it's the new MLM. And I'm like, okay, MLM and coaching are different, but they are very much adjacent in terms of the strategies they use and the way that they look. But there is no product and there is no company in coaching, but it very much is like a pyramid of coaches who coach coaches. So I will give them that. Perfectly said. I'm so disappointed because I always liked Amy Porterfield. I'm a business owner and I really found many of her podcasts, etc., helpful and informative. She took B school and is an affiliate of Marie Forleo too. I used to think she disliked Tony, but too many people in common. Same. When I found Amy, when I was first starting out with my small biz, I was searching for business podcasts and came across hers. After investing quite a bit in LBS, B School, Copy Cure, and sadly several other online courses, I've finally come to realize I drank the Kool-Aid. I've never liked Tony Robbins and was like you in thinking she disliked Tony. I don't believe I have ever seen them together since she left his company, but they travel in the exact same circles. Exactly. It's a productless pyramid scheme, almost. That's what I call it. But then people are like, well, the person at the top doesn't directly benefit from, you know, the downline. I'm like, okay, I get that. But the person in the bottom wouldn't exist if the person at the top didn't exist. They just like copy, paste, copy, paste, copy, paste. It's Tony's all the way down. Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Tony creates mini clones. I need a hobby before I end up at one of their live events. No! Okay. This is what I will say. So this person is saying like they used to like her podcast and whatever. I did a deep dive on Brooke Castillo. If you haven't seen that video, I'm assuming most of you have. And in that video, I talk about how like I first found Brooke Castillo many years ago. I used to listen to her podcast. I think some of the content she shares is genuinely helpful. And I think that a lot of these like grifters do sometimes share helpful information, but the important piece is like, they aren't the inventors of that information. A lot of the times they're regurgitating it from someone else, but then they're taking that same information and packaging it into this like $400, $500, $1,000 course and then selling it to you like it's brand new top secret info that it's like, I just got it for free from their podcast. So go ahead and listen to these people. Listen to their free content. Watch their YouTube videos. Listen to their podcast. I don't care, but do not give them your money. Get the ad people to give them their money. Okay, we got the tea. Rights Mind says, I don't know what that means. I'm not into the lingo. To dig on our girl, Amy. Two sealed court cases in Ventura, California, several business partners, and the 13 plus aliases she has used. Oh my God. Okay, this is one thing that I haven't done a lot of research on, but I've heard allegedly, apparently on the internet is what I read, and it might not be fact, but it's alleged, is a lot of these businesses operate under like pseudonyms. Is that the right word? Like fake names, but like multiple fake names. I think it's for like tax purposes, but they filter the money into like all of these different businesses. Very, very interesting. Yeah, they're all connected. Amy Porterfield and Jenna Kutcher are like BFF. In fact, I was snooping on Jenna Kutcher the other day. I don't remember why. And she had recently shared a post with Amy Porterfield. Yeah. We'll just zoom right in here. Let me share this tab instead. You can see the two of them snuggled up on the couch there. I think we all should have our one person, at least that makes us feel like we're never alone. And then it says, who is this friend for you? I honestly couldn't do this life as an entrepreneur without daily voice memos from my girl, Amy Porterfield. From a mentor to a friend, I consider her my coworker at this point. Entrepreneurship has a tendency to become isolating while we're working hard on our little islands and feeling like no one understands. That's why it's absolutely critical that you find your person. Okay, I don't disagree with that. It is hard to like work for yourself and feel like nobody in your life understands what you're doing. And I have a group of friends that are all content creators and we hang out and we ask each other for advice and it is really helpful. So I'm not going to like crap on this because I do agree with what she's saying. I mostly just wanted to show this because it's like they're all connected to each other. Not only has Amy become my BFF, but she's also taught me everything I know about building and selling online courses, of course. Okay, so this is just a promo for Amy's program. So they're all just cross-promoting each other. We hate that. We hate it so much. Okay, sorry. Let me catch up on the comments again. Yeah, exactly. You only get info recycled for the 8 weeks from all their speakers. That's it. That's all it is. Save your money. Okay, so she has businesses in California, an office in Nashville, and Delaware office for taxes. Interesting. Basically, a way to minimize risk when it comes to scamming people. Makes sense. Put that money everywhere. That's like Jen Shah was sending a bunch of money offshore, allegedly, apparently, from what I heard on a podcast that I listened to. Yeah, we really do hate a transactional friendship around here. You know what we don't hate is real friendship, like the one DC and I have that we're going to be talking about in an hour when you guys all come and hang out with us. Did you like that transition? Let me know how smooth I was. Okay. Dean is banned from doing what he's doing and he's still doing it. Yes, yes, yes. 12 out of 10 transition. Yeah, thank you. I really thought that one through. Okay, back to the Reddit thread. Sorry, my ADHD is peaking this evening. Okay, I'll go for like 10 minutes more and then I'm gonna just chill for an hour before we come back together. Okay, here's a good post on the spider web that is the MLM self-help cult. Okay, buckle up and grab popcorn. Let's go, baby. Oh, somebody made a whole... Oh, this is Rachel K. Albers. Okay, another great person you should follow on Instagram. We love her. But in like a non-culty way. The cult of online marketing made easy. Rachel, Jenna, Amy, the curious case of the SEO optimized friendship. 100%. How does this look? Okay. Yes. Welcome if you are new here. This channel is about exposing, not exposing so much as debunking a lot of the rhetoric used in the online coaching industry to hopefully help in mitigating the coaches phenomenon that tends to be all the rage today all over the internet. So welcome if you're new here. In late 2020, Tyler J. McCall recorded a live video where he denounced his business mentors, James Wedmore and Brooke Castillo, citing what he had learned about their Trump support and QAnon ties. Then the video disappeared. What happened? What does all of this have to do with Rachel Hollis, Jenna Kutcher, and Amy Porterfield? Is Tony Robbins in on it? And how the hell did I get mixed up in this? I feel like 36-year-old Harriet the Spy, except I also happen to be an expert in my field. I'm a brand strategist turned business comedian turned court jester of the royal shit show that is online marketing. Once upon a time, I built brands for hundreds of entrepreneurs. I was the rebrand whisperer, taking a brand in transition from business model to marketing strategy to messaging to creative direction to brand and web design. The Monday after the Capitol insurrection, I woke up and after 12 years of 7-day weeks, endlessly, hapless, trying to scale as I served hundreds of entrepreneurs, helping them wrestle with the unwieldy funnels somebody with a slick webinar convinced them that they needed something broke. Burnout is a bright red flag waving you in the direction of exactly what you need to burn down next. Saw this coming a mile away. Okay. The burnout as old as time and the brand that came before it are both important here because they answer the question, why do you care? And the follow-up, where do you find the time to follow these people? I care because I spent 12 years cleaning up their messes. I'm not a disgruntled customer. I just work with other people's disgruntled customers. I didn't find the time my clients paid me to pay attention to these folks. I watched who they watched. Okay, I'm going to keep reading, but first I'm going to drop this link in the live chat if anyone else wants to like read along or just have it for reference. I all recommend you go and follow Rachel on Instagram. She shares some pretty funny stuff. So here are the people that, so basically she worked for clients who followed these like queen grifters, we shall say. So many great faces here that I could cover in a million other videos. In the beginning, my very first client might be a witch because she told me to watch and copy Marie Forleo all those years ago, which ultimately inspired my most popular blog post of all time, You Don't Want Marie Forleo's Website. The same client had me transcribe Marie's Live in the Moment bootcamp back when robots weren't a thing, so I believe I took the early prototype of her upcoming time management program, Time Genius. This was all back when Amy Porterfield marketed herself as a Facebook expert and yet hadn't graduated to being the girl boss next door of the entire online marketing industrial complex. It might explain why Amy is clinging so fiercely to the funnel she rode to the top. They helped her go from just another Facebook surf to queen of the good girls. Amy worked for Tony Robbins, but then she broke free by spending $20,000 in Marie Forleo's Rich, Happy, and Hot Mastermind, alongside Laura Belgray and Laura Roeder. I don't know who either of those people are. All roads lead back to Tony Robbins. Repeat it like a mantra. I only know this because all my clients that saw this coming a mile away told me, seething with envy that she wasn't in the room where it happened. Okay. Yes, this client of mine consumed courses and masterminds and three-day $10,000 retreats like I devoured every second of John Hamm and Mad Men. I spent years with her trying to make sense of what my traditional marketing education meant in an online marketing world, because for the six figures she invested in the secrets to end all secrets at the end of someone's silky smooth sales pitch, she never seemed to find it. The secret, that is. The pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. At first, I thought I was a bad steward of these systems, but then the patterns presented to me again and again and again. 12 years of examples just like this, and I rarely met the type of case study student you'll find as testy, shiny, or as shiny testimonials on all these celebrity entrepreneur websites. So she's saying she met so many people that followed these gurus and never seemed to have the results that are shared on these people's website, which is, again, something we've talked about many times on this channel. I worked with hundreds of brilliant business leaders trying to move from brick and mortar to www, ensnared early on by the smooth stylings of someone who knows their way around a webinar, only to spend money they didn't really have on systems that were never going to serve them. And then they showed up at my door with nothing left in the budget, nothing much to show for all of Marie Forleo's promises that the world needs that special gift that only you have. Everyone can be an expert in anything. You just have to decide that you're an expert. But because they invested so much in this snake oil, including and especially their trust, most of my clients insisted that I find a way to fit their business into these misshapen funnels. They believed there was something wrong with them, not the model. To be fair, so did I. So they hired my agency to fix it. Okay, this article is exceptionally long. Sorry, I just realized. Oh my God, it goes forever. Okay, I have it linked in the comments if you want to keep reading. I thought it was going to be more about why they're all friends. And while it's interesting, it's not interesting enough for me to continue to want to read it because my throat hurts. But I will say that I agree with this statement. Jenna was confused because I was referring to a friendship was no more than a corporate partnership. And I think this ties back to what Hannah, I think it was, already suggested in the comments. The friendships seem transactional. Let's be friends on the internet so I can promote you and you can promote me. I have no problem with cross promotion, but when it comes with an affiliate link, it seems a little bit more or a little bit less genuine. Okay, sorry. Sorry I cut that off so abruptly. I just I'm a little bit overstimulated, I think, and I don't think I would have made it through that article. So I do apologize. But if we want to read it on another stream, okay, thank you. It's a podcast transcript. Thank you. Okay. Let's do that. Let's save this for another day and we'll listen to it because I can't talk anymore. Yeah, I love it. Yeah, well, thank you so much for being here. Lots of people spend a lot of money, myself included, on fluffy garbage, as I like to call it. So we're just out here doing the work, you know? We can bring the kazoo. Yes, I love it. So DC and I are actually reacting to part two of a stream she did last night. where Jessie Lee Ward is like recording herself recording a podcast. So it's podcast inception. Exactly. This is like the point that I always make with people is like, I sell an online course. It's very affordable in my opinion. And the intention behind the course is that you take the course and then you never have to talk to me. You don't need me anymore. I'm selling you the inputs in hopes that you will get the outputs you're looking for, but I'm not promising you that you're going to be a millionaire. So what these people do is they sell you on a dream and then they continue to sell you on an even bigger dream and an even bigger dream than that. And it just never seems to end. So yes, thank you. We can table things for when the brain cooties are calmer. I appreciate that. I love it. I love it here. All right, friends. Well, I'm going to take a break so that I can hopefully shake my brain back into place. And then I'll be back in an hour with DC. So I'm looking forward to that. I appreciate you all for following my many, many directions that this stream took. But I think all around we had a good time. So at least I had a good time. If you didn't have a good time, be sure to give this video a big thumbs down on your way out. Okay. I appreciate it. All right. No worries if you're not. We'll catch you on the replay. Those of you watching the replay, appreciate you. Take care. Comb your hair. And I'll see you in a few once I figure out how to put up the end screen as always. Okay, bye.